संतोषयता संतौ श्रील रूप सनातनौ दाक्षिणात्येन भट्टेन पुनरेतद्विविच्यते तस्याद्यं ग्रंथनालेकं क्रांतव्युत्क्रांतखंडितं पर्यालोच्यात पर्यायं कृत्वा लिखति जीवकः। सो दिस मंगलाचरणम। सो वी आर स्टार्टिंग अवर क्लास विद दि रिसाइटेशन ऑफ मंगलाचरणम। सो बिफोर गोइंग टू the exact discussion of the course, so we'll be just I'll be speaking few words about the course. So as mentioned in our brochure also and while registering online students, so 21 students are there. So when you registered, and also you might have seen our on-site students also, both. This is the course, 70 sessions course. Each session is a 1.5 hour time. Every day we'll be having our discussion in the same time, 6:30 to 8 p.m. every day. And these are 70 hours, 70 sessions. That means almost all 105 hours. So 105 hours, and we are going to cover 153 anuchedas of the Bhakti Sandarbha. Bhakti Sandarbha is having total of 336 anuchedas are there total. So in those, we are going to cover in the module 1, 153 anuchedas. Anucheda means it is a chapter, you can say in English. Anuscheda means it's a chapter. So we are going to experience what is Anuscheda when the course and when we go into the details of, and when we start the discussion of the course, then we'll understand. So that is the thing, and we'll be having the exams as much as, so tentative dates I will soon give, but so first of all, I want to see how the flow will go. That means the students' caliber also I want to understand, because many new students also came. So when the sufficiently data is covered, so I will be announcing. That means after covering some little portion of the syllabus, so I can announce the date for the exam. Already many students are there even in the online. So they studied with us Tattva Sandarbha. So you all have the experience of the exams, in the exams how they conduct for, but new students, some new students also are there now. So exams will be asking whatever the things we covered in the classes, the same thing is tested. Nothing you need to do more. And so also exam pattern is, we'll be having the 50 marks of each exam, and it's a 1.5 hour time we'll give, and the pass mark is 65% is the pass. 65% of out of 50, 65% of marks you should get out of total. So that is a pass, and whoever is passing all the exams, they will be given with the certificate from ISKCON Bhagavat Mahavidyalaya. So that means so and so devotee passed successfully of this module of Sandarbha, like that. So this is the thing, this awarding will be there. And we'll try to, so last time we have given few assignments. So assignments will not be carrying any marks, but that means in the final evaluation, so we don't include assignments. In the Tattva Sandarbha also we didn't include. The same way, so we are not going to include the assignments, the marks for the assignments. But we'll be giving the assignments as need base. So wherever some topic is important, if you submit, then you'll be getting the feedback also, your learning how it is, so you can check with us. So assignments is optional. That means it's one way you can say it's optional. So maybe this is present plan. Assignments plan may change also. If we see the people's preparation is lacking and their performance is poor in the exams, then we'll start the strictly the assignments also. So, but presently, time being, we are relaxing this, but it doesn't mean that they not preparing. So we'll see that the first exam, how they write and they perform. And if there is any necessary, we are ready to take any action at any time. So we can change our plan also. So that much freedom we are keeping with us. So because ultimately our intention is our every student has to so nicely utilize their time because they registered for this course and they should get the maximum benefit. So in that direction, so we try to work. So this is the one point about the exams and assessment and assignments. And also many students, all of you know each other, and online students, just make a note, you are also having here on-site classmates. On-site and online classmates is a together club. It is a hybrid class actually. So in the hybrid class, you are having on-site students. Almost all you will be having here on the in front of me. So 3 plus 3, 6, 6 plus 3, 9, 9 plus 3, 12, 12 plus 4, 16. 16 students are sitting in front of me. So you should understand that how we are going to handle the class, that also we should understand. So whenever the on-site students, they ask question, so their question you also can hear because they will be speaking in the phone, in the mic, and that is also mixed with our Zoom, and so that you can hear their question. And also whatever you speak, that also everyone is able to hear here, not only me. So this kind of setup we are having here. So that's why I also sincerely request our on-site students. So you should be careful and you should be maintain your decency and attention. Whenever you want to speak, you speak in the mic, not the independently. If you speak, then they are able to hear only my voice and they are not able to hear your question. So it is a disconnection actually. So that's why there is a problem if you do like that. And I should not waste my energy for every student. Please speak in the mic. Please speak in the mic. It is very irritating and very so bad thing actually, bad practice. Already we have 3 months of experience. So I request all of you this to follow. Okay. So next, on-site students also, online students, if they have any doubt, they can raise the hand. So virtual hand they can raise. So that option is there always with you. And you are always connected with the Atul Gopal Prabhu. So what is happening? You see, I am sitting in front of you and I am not operating your camera. So I am not operating Zoom account is not in my hands actually. So we are having our so good devotee Atul Gopal Prabhu with us. So he is always so asking you to open your camera, and also whenever you ask some question, immediately he will inform to me. So he's just in front of me. So he is operating the Zoom account. So if you are raising hands, then he comes to know, and then he will notify to me. So then I will immediately take your question. And also I am able to see your screen. It is displayed in a big screen in front of me. So I am seeing all of your faces, but control is not in my hand. So Atul Gopal Prabhu is handling that. That you should understand, so that you should have overall class setup how it is. So this is the point. And about the classroom. And anyway, introduction, we have more or less, that means 4 or 5 students, extra students, that means who extra means not extra, so new students. Many students already they did with us Tattva Sandarbha course online and on-site also both. And 90%, 80% of students, they already old students only. So as classes progresses, so everyone will come to know each other. So about the other classmates. So that's why I'm not taking much time to have an introduction of the individual introduction. You will come to know as time progresses and also by that time. Okay. About this. And yeah. Okay, we'll start our discussion. And many students, almost all everyone, they know about the sandarbhas. They have basic idea about the sandarbhas, because many are doing this. That means this is the second time. That means second sandarbha they are studying. So first sandarbha is the tattva sandarbha, and this second sandarbha is the we are teaching bhakti sandarbha. But actually, in the sequence, if you see, second sandarbha is the Bhagavat sandarbha. After that, Paramatma sandarbha, and next Krishna sandarbha, Bhakti sandarbha, and Priti sandarbha. So many students, they might be having the doubt, why you people started, why your institute is teaching after Tattva sandarbha immediately Bhakti sandarbha. Why this is? So one may get this kind of question. So the main reason is one of the main reason is, first we are teaching the tattva sandarbha because, so you should understand the first pramana khanda. What is pramana? Highest pramana. So after establishing Srimad Bhagavatam, so we are teaching tattva sandarbha to understand the authenticity or the supremacy of Srimad Bhagavatam. And then after that, basic understanding we get of the tattva by studying tattva sandarbha. So that is, first we need. Then after that, we are not going to the Bhagavat sandarbha and Paramatma and Krishna sandarbha. One reason is, main reason, they are very complex actually compared to Bhakti sandarbha. They are very quite complex, and also teaching itself is a challenge, and learning itself is also a challenge. And also, not only that, this Bhagavat, Paramatma, and the Krishna sandarbha, these things are telling about the sambandhi tattvam only. That anyway, so we all know from our So basic studies from Bhakti Shastri and other books of Srila Prabhupada, all they have studied. So those students only we are taking for this course. The course minimum eligibility we kept is Bhakti Shastri, or otherwise at least 10 years of their experience in Krishna consciousness. This was the basic requirement, so they have the basic knowledge about the Bhagwan and also Krishna. So then after that, as a devotee, as a sadhaka, we need to know thoroughly about the bhakti. So by knowing the bhakti, it will helpful our sadhana. So that is one of the main focus, and it is integrated with our 1 year course in on-site. In on-site, we are teaching so 6 cantos of the Bhagavatam, and also we are teaching the tattva sandarbha and Bhakti sandarbha. So keeping this also into account, that on-site students, so they should, we are giving the one complete, that means one capsule. So where some sadhana, that means sadhana bhakti, bhakti sandarbha is mainly dealing with the sadhana bhakti. So that's why they will be understanding as a sadhaka about the sadhana bhakti nicely. And also they will get the basic understanding on Srimad Bhagavatam, and they learn 6 cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam. So this is a one package. So that this course is designed 1 year on-site course. And also we are offering these subjects. So whatever for the on-site students is going on, same thing is we are going to offer on the online also. So like this, online students also are getting opportunity to hear. So these courses. So that is the main reason, actually focusing mainly on the on-site students. So this course is designed so that it is also going to give benefits for the online students also. Many students, they don't have much deep background in the Sanskrit, and also reading the Acharya's commentaries, or otherwise the analyzing the Sanskrit text. So, and also darshanas, the 6 darshanas knowledge is also not there with us. So that's why dealing the Bhagavat sandarbha, Paramatma, and Krishna sandarbha is quite challenging actually. So the students, it's not like just Bhagavatam, that means it's not like just so our so it's not easy class actually, because it demands the some Shaddarshanas knowledge and also some basic Sanskrit knowledge you should get, then you can easy, it is easy for the teacher to handle the class. So that's why in the future we are going to do the some initial homework, and then we will introduce the other sandarbhas also. But bhakti sandarbha is very easy and very relishing, and this is the experience we got from the first batch. So already one batch, so they studied the tattva sandarbha and bhakti sandarbha with us, and they from after teaching them, and we also experienced. So the best, that means even the feedback also we got, they are very happy. So in studying the bhakti sandarbha, and even they faced some little difficulty in the tattva sandarbha, but in the case of bhakti sandarbha it was not there. And so that, so to encourage your interest towards the sandarbhas, so that is also one more reason to have the bhakti sandarbha with us, so to teach here now, so that you will be appreciate the sandarbhas very deeply. Otherwise you may think, oh, it's a very hard subject and it's not for me. And any bhakti shastri student easily can understand bhakti sandarbha also. Whoever passed bhakti shastri, they can easily understand, because so in the bhakti rasamrita sindhu first 19 chapters your eastern wave, you'll be learning the sadhana bhakti, even the 17 chapters only, not the so total 19 chapters. So even in the bhakti sandarbha we are not going to learn bhava bhakti and so prema bhakti is not discussed actually. Only in the bhakti sandarbha is a sadhana bhakti. So that means vaidhi bhakti and raganuga bhakti both are discussed before this. So about the basic many things about the bhakti, aspects of bhakti and philosophical aspects of the bhakti are very much discussed, so that online students also very easily they can follow it, and they can also so start appreciating the sandarbhas. And ultimately our goal is, so you should appreciate the sandarbhas, and it should lead to your appreciation to so our Srila Prabhupada books, so that they can nicely understand the what our so Prabhupada gave in our books, that also you can easily understand, oh, this is coming from here, so this is the aspect, this is the root so for our philosophy from here. So if you speak some aspect of our siddhanta, so that is coming from this sloka, so from this sloka Bhagavatam, so it is taken and it is established by our acharya, so that's why later acharyas they followed. So like that you will be appreciating our later coming acharyas. So after Jiva Goswami, so many acharyas came, and they are also so emphasizing the same aspects and same philosophical points. So you can see their chastity, that means they're sincerely following their previous acharyas, so that will also appreciate, and that will bring in us also to appreciate and follow this sincerely and strictly our previous our parampara. So that is also one more our goal, desired goal. We want to see that kind of appreciation from the every student. Of course we don't want any appreciation for me or for this institute, but the main we expect our appreciation, all of your appreciation towards our acharya parampara and also our Srila Prabhupada. So that is the main our interest. And now so we will be opening our introduction file. If you open your introduction file, please open your introduction file. So online students, are you able to get these two files or not? If anyone is having any difficulty and someone's name is not added to the account, that means group, that WhatsApp group, so please let me know and raise the hand. And if you didn't get, so we can share now. That's why I think everyone have the file. So introduction file first, I will do this introduction class. Then after that I will discuss about the Mangalacharanam also. If time is there, then we can discuss about the Mangalacharanam sloka also, meaning of Mangalacharanam. So Mangalacharanam file is in that another file. Mangalacharanam is in another file. Now introduction, so we are going to have now. So many of you already heard the definition of the sandarbha, because we discussed this thing in Tattva Sandarbha course. So what is the definition of the Sandarbha? Gudarthasya prakashascha sarokti sreshtata tatha nanardhavatvam vedyatvam sandarbha katyate budai. Many students, they may have this kind of doubt. What is Sandarbha? Why this word is given for this book? So any name is given means it is having this some nimitta. Nimitta means karana, cause. There is a some cause. So I am not seeing the some students, they are not putting on their cameras. So if I see your transcendental faces, it will be encouraging for me. So they are getting, and by seeing the faces also we can understand whether they are sleeping or getting or doing something, so we can understand. That's why please, so put on your cameras so that we can always see your faces, or otherwise sometimes there is a chance to do other work also. If camera is off, then our mind will switch to do another work, so instead of having full attention. So that's why we request all of the students, so to put on, online students to put on then camera always on, and that is the part of our course. And also you should wear the proper devotee dress and having the tilak, and this is a minimum expectation. And so everyone please, and if you have really some problem, then you should discuss with Atul Gopal Prabhu, otherwise he will not leave you. So if you don't put on your camera on, then he'll keep on sending the messages to you. So that's why, so if you want to escape from this, so please put on your camera on. Gudarthasya, now come to our discussion. Gudarthasya prakashascha saroktihi shreshtata tatha nanardavatvam vedyatvam sandarbha katyate budaihi. This is a memorization sloka. Everyone should memorize this, because you are all Sandarbha students now. And if anyone asks what is Sandarbha, and for your purpose, and also for preaching purpose also, it is very necessary. What is this Sandarbha means? The wise say a Sandarbha is the revelation of the deep meanings. That means Gudardasya Prakashascha is an exposition of the essence. So Saroktihi, Sreshtata means excellence of the main text. Next, Nanarthavattu. Prabhu, you can see in your laptop. You don't have file? Because it will fill the screen, na? So that's why it will be giving. Okay, so nanarthavatvam vedyatvam, so that means many meanings, the various meanings of the main text, so are known as, so and the various meanings which should be known as sandarbha. Sandarbha means collection of all these of the main text is known as sandarbha. The collection of all of these of main text is known as sandarbha. So this is Sandarbha. If you want to, then what Bhagava Sandarbha will do? Bhagava Sandarbha will, in the main text, in the place of main text, you should keep simply Bhagavatam. So Bhagava Sandarbha will deal what? So what is the main text for the Bhagava Sandarbha? Bhagavatam. So that means, so what is the meaning of Bhagava Sandarbha? Bhagava Sandarbha means it is the collection of deep meanings of Srimad Bhagavatam, is an exposition of the essence of Srimad Bhagavatam, is an excellence of the Srimad Bhagavatam, and is the various meanings of Srimad Bhagavatam. So like this, that is a Bhagava Sandarbha. Shat Sandarbhas are also known as Bhagava Sandarbha. Shat Sandarbhas are also known as Bhagava Sandarbha. That means total 6 Sandarbhas. Tattva Sandarbha, Bhagava Sandarbha, Paramatma Sandarbha, Krishna Sandarbha, Bhakti Sandarbha, and Priti Sandarbha. These six Sandarbhas all together are known as Bhagavat Sandarbha. So, what is the difference between this total six Sandarbhas are known as Bhagavat Sandarbha and second one? Second one is Bhagavat Sandarbha. And total is known as Bhagavat Sandarbha. Bhagavat Sandarbha. Okay. So now we understood what are these six Sandarbhas. Just that means six Sandarbhas are dealing the Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam is the main text. So if you want to know nicely Srimad Bhagavatam, then what you should do? You should study Shat Sandarbhas. That means Shat Sandarbhas are going to help you to understand nicely Srimad Bhagavatam. That is the purpose of Shat Sandarbhas. Why we have to study Shat Sandarbhas? Many people, they have this doubt. So because for Gaudiya Vaishnavas, what is the ultimate scripture actually? For the Gaudiya Vaishnavas, Bhagavatam is the ultimate scripture. And that is the emperor actually. Emperor, that means any pramana, if you want to check, then you have to check in the guidance of, in the light of Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam is the king. He's not king, it's the emperor. So among the pramanas, who is the emperor pramana? Srimad Bhagavatam. And that Srimad Bhagavatam can be nicely known by studying the Shat Sandarbhas. So before writing the Shat Sandarbha, Srila Jiva Goswami is writing the Mangalacharanam, that we have seen in the Tattva Sandarbha. There are the total 8 slokas of Mangalacharanam are there. So in this Mangalacharanam slokas, in the final sloka, he is giving the summary of Shat Sandarbhas. In the Shat Sandarbhas, what he is going to deal, so that he summarized in one sloka. So that's why if you come to know this one sloka, if you understand this one sloka, you are going to understand the summary of all the six Sandarbhas. So what is that one sloka which is summarizing the six Sandarbhas? Is the Yasya Brahmeti Sangyam Kochidapi Nigame Yati Chinmatra Satta Vyam So Yasyam Shakai Swair Vibhavati Vashayanne Vamayam Pumamscha Ekam Yasyaiva Rupam Vilasati Paramavyomni Narayanakyam Sasri Krishno Vidhattam Swayamiha Bhagavan Prema Tatpada Bhajam. This is the final sloka of Mangalacharanam given by Srila Jiva Goswami before writing these six Sandarbhas. So, and also he is giving the one sloka for each Sandarbha as Mangalacharanam sloka. Just Tau Santosha Yata Santo, just before starting class we read. That sloka is meant for the Bhakti Sandarbha. That is a Mangalacharanam sloka for the Bhakti Sandarbha. And these 8 Mangalacharanas slokas are the meant for the total Bhagavat Sandarbha, for six Sandarbhas. For total Sandarbha, he wrote these eight Mangalacharana slokas. In that 8th one, this is. And what is the meaning of this? May Sri Krishna, Bhagavan, Swayam, whose existence as pure consciousness is defined in some scriptures as Brahman, whose Amsha, the Purushavatara, controlling Maya, shines with his expansions, and one of whose forms called Narayana, place in Vaikuntha, give prema to those who worship his feet in this world. See, this one sloka is summarizing everything. So, I try to sometimes for the encouragement of the some Sanskrit students who know Sanskrit some little bit, we try to do that means for their understanding. Sometimes I use this Anvaya also. So if you are not able to get that, don't worry. But If you are able to get that, then try to do Anvaya with me. I don't do every time, but sometimes for some cases I do. So that you can understand the text very easily. What is the advantage of doing Anvaya? So is the main meaning of this sloka easily you can understand. There is a purpose actually. So that's why we are, for the on-site students, we are conducting regularly Sanskrit classes also. So which will be started tomorrow onwards. So these Sanskrit classes, Paramsundara Prabhu is going to start tomorrow onwards. So okay, now come to this sloka, try to understand the meaning. What is the summary of these sandarbhas? So it's said in this sloka. First of all, what is the kriya in this? What is the main kriya? Vidhattam. That means, what is the meaning of vidhattam? Lord Krishna may give. May give. Okay. May Sri Krishna give. So Sri Krishna should give. What he should give? What he should give? Sri Krishna may give. Tat Prema. What he should give? Prema he should give. To whom? To whom? Prema to every living entity? No. Prema to not to every living entity. To the devotees who take the shelter at his lotus feet. Tat Pada Bhajam. That means whoever worshipping the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. Lotus feet of him. So to them, he may give prema. Okay? That's why if you want to understand any sloka, what you should do? You first take out the verb. Then after that, verb means action. So who is doing this action? Try to understand that. So then action will be applied on some object. Then what is that? That is the object you should understand. This action is done by what? And this action's result is going to whom? So this action is starting from where? So this action is happening in which location? If you put these questions, then if you answer, then that will become the total meaning. So that's why if you want to understand any sloka nicely, so best first you should try to identify the kriya. So okay. So Krishna, may Krishna give prema to the devotees who worship his lotus feet. So what kind of Sri Krishna? Swayam Bhagavan. He is Lord himself. Krishnastu Bhagavan Swayam. Sota Goswami also saying in the Srimad Bhagavatam, we discussed this. So ete chamsa kalapam saha Krishnastu Bhagavan Swayam. So here Swayam Sri Krishna is the Bhagavan and he may give prema to the devotees who worship his lotus feet. And who? That's Krishna. So who is he? And we want to see. That means here you should understand that Krishna may give love to the devotees who worship his lotus feet. From this line, you will be understanding completely what is the object, what is the subject matter for us? Subject matter of discussion is Krishna. Who should give? Krishna should give. So that's why Krishna is the our subject. So which we are going to discuss. Okay. So next, whom he should give prema? To the devotees who worship his lotus feet. So worshippers. That means worshipping activity. Whoever is doing the worshipping activity, to them prema should be given. So that's why worshipping of him is the practice. That means that is the abhidheya. Worshipping him is the abhidheya. Krishna is the subject matter, and worshipping is the abhidheya. Krishna is also known as sambandhi tattvam. You note it. Why sambandhi tattva? I am saying that you'll understand later. So Krishna is the sambandhi tattvam. Please note it. Krishna is the sambandhi tattvam, and bhakti is the abhidheya. And by worshipping him, so what he should give? What is the result? Prema. So prema is the prayojanam. It is the prayojanam. Okay. And now this Krishna, who is he? Saha Sri Krishna. Saha Kaha, who is he? That is explained in the above three lines. In above three lines. Yasya Brahmeti Sangyam Kochidapi Yati Chinmatri Kochidapi Negame Yati Chinmatra Satta. This Sri Krishna is also having a notation, Sangya, in some Vedas, Upanishads. In Upanishads, this Krishna is known or is denoted by what Sangya? What is that Sangya? Brahmeti. So that means, Kochit means you should understand, Kochidapi Negame, that means some places of Vedas. Negama means Vedas are the Upanishads. So Upanishads are the part of the Vedas. In the Vedas, how he is denoted in some places, he is also known as Brahma. So Brahma, and he is defined, how he is defined? When he is called as Brahma, at that time, how he was defined? Chinmatra Satta. He was defined as Chinmatra Satta. So that's why, that means in Shastras, Krishna is some places defined as Chinmatra Satta, and at the in that case, then he is denoted as Brahma. Brahma is different and Brahma. Brahma and Brahma. Brahma, Dirga is there, then that is Chaturmukhi Brahma. Without Dirga, after Hakara, Ma. So he is getting the notation of Brahma. Okay, next. Amsho yasyamshakaihi swaihi vibhavati vashyanneva mayam pumamscha. And what else? So who's Hamsha? Whose Amsha is Purushavatara, and he is controlling Maya, and he is also cause for the various expansions. Who is that? So generally we have three Purushavataras. That means this Krishna's Amshas are, that means first what we learn in the first line, whose notation is Brahman, so that is who? That is Krishna. And also second line is saying that who is having the various Purushavataras, and he is the cause for the controlling Maya, or otherwise he controls the Maya and he controls the Jiva, and also he is the cause for the various avataras. So in this Brahmanda, so who is the Bija for the all the avataras? So in one Brahmanda, if you take, in that Brahmanda, who is the Bija for the all the avataras? Is the Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. Yes. Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. Yes. Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu is the cause for the all the, is a Bija for the all the avataras. So that means all Purusha avataras. So out of that, this Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu, so from him only first three Gunavataras are coming. Gunavataras are coming. First, Brahmaji is coming. Brahmaji is coming from whom? Brahmaji is coming from Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. From his lotus, from his navel. So there is lotus flower is coming, and there, so Brahmaji is appearing. So that's why, so all these Gunavataras are coming from, Bija for the Gunavataras also is the Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. And from the Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu only, Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu's expansion. That means Vilasa Rupa, Vilasa Avatara. Vilasa form is Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu. So what is the difference between Vilasa and Amsha? In the case of Amsha, so that means only some portion of energy is carried from the amshi. For example, so Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu is the amsha of the Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu. So in this case, what is happening? So some portion of energy is carried, not the total. So then it is known as amsha. Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu is the amsha of Karanarnava Sai Vishnu. Yes. Next, from the Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu, who is coming? Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu. Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu is what? Vilasa of the Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. So that's why Vilasa means energy difference will not be there. Potencies are same, almost all same. But only change is form. Form is changing. So that's why Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu is the Vilasa of Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. What is the difference between the Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu and Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu? Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu form and Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu form? Garbhodaka Sai, then you are saying Vilasa, Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu. Then what is the difference between the form? What kind of difference is there? So anyone knows, online students? Sachdev, Prabhu. Okay, tell.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Yeah. Prabhuji, regarding this Vilasa form, Kshirodaksha Vishnu, it's a 400 form. And Garbhodaksha Vishnu is, I think, not 400 form.
What form then?
200 form.
200. Okay.
It may be wrong. Yeah, it may be wrong.
Okay, next. Who is going to? Okay, no problem. We'll take only one. Enough. So I will tell the answer. So Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu is having the multiple hands. Sahasra Shirsha, Sahasrapa. So he is having the numerous hands. So it is, who is the Pramana? In the third canto, 8th chapter, it is given. The form of the Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu is described. And he is having the multiple hands and multiple heads and multiple legs. Like how Karanarnava Sai Vishnu also looks. So he also looks the same way. But Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu is having only 4 hands. So this is in this way, the form is different, but the potencies are same. So that's why Kshirodaka Sai Vishnu is the Vilasa of this. And now what? These all Purusha avatars are coming from whom originally? From that Krishna only. And this Purusha avatara is the all Purusha avatara's purpose, is main purpose is what? Controlling the Maya. Mayam Pumamscha. He is going to control whom? He is going to control the Maya. And he is the cause for the various avatars. Okay, next. Ekam yasyaiva rupam vilasati paramavyomni narayanakhyam. And this Sri Krishna is only, that means his, this Mahavir, this Vishnu, Narayana in the spiritual sky, that is Paramavyoma. So this Narayana is a form of Krishna only. Yasyaiva rupam. That's why Narayana is not different from, so Krishna, he is not different. Actually, if you see Brahma Mohan Leela, Brahmaji is praying. So he is saying about the Narayana. And he is calling, very nice discussions there. Anyway, it's a big discussion. And there you can see. So he is asking forgiveness. Brahmaji is asking forgiveness. So I am so full Muda. He is identifying himself as Muda. And saying that, so what I did? I am going to test. I started testing you. Krishna is standing in front of him and he's saying, so such a foolish thing I did. I'm so ignorant. And who am I? So I am just having the size of 7 spans of hand. One span is this, jhana. So like this, if you measure your height, how much this much? 7. Total 7 spans of hand will be equal to your height. You can measure yourself. Yeah, you can measure. You will be the So seven. So I am having this much height and I am in the one Brahmanda. So residing in this one Brahmanda. And these Brahmandas are just pore, that means hanging, or is staying on your pores of your hair. Like how sometimes when light falls, the sun rays are falling on the window, so then you'll be seeing in that sunlight lot of dust particles are just so rising up and just roaming around there. So hundreds and thousands of the dust particles like that. All these Brahmandas are the dust particles on the pores of the Karnanosai Vishnu, and that Karnanosai Vishnu is coming from you. That means I am belonging to the, so according to the, with respect to the one dust particle. I am staying in one dust particle, and I started testing you. See my foolishness. What a fool I am. So he is just understanding, that means how much he was having the ignorance before, so having this leela. So then after that he understood Krishna is the cause for the all the Vishnu forms, the other his friends, gopas and the cows, everyone. So when Brahmaji came there, so Krishna is having all these friends and everyone cows, they became immediately the Narayana forms, Vishnu forms. And that means Krishna is standing in between, and hundreds and thousands and millions of Vishnus are just surrounding to him. And Brahmaji is just folding his hands and standing in front of him. And behind Brahmaji also, thousands of Brahmajis came and they were standing. Then Brahmaji understood, what I did? So I thought this boy is simply a cowherd boy. And I started testing. I applied my Maya on him. And I just hided his sons, his friends and his cows. Such a foolish thing I did. And he can bewilder even the masters of Maya. So such a potency you are having. So like this, so Brahmaji is glorifying. So main point to discuss is that Krishna is the cause for the even the Narayana. And that Krishna is the cause for the all the Purushavataras. And that Krishna is known as, in some places of Vedas, as Brahma. So, and that Krishna may give prema to the devotees who worship his lotus feet. This is the summary of all the six sandarbhas. He summarized in this way. So from this you should understand sambandhi tattvam. That means the subject matter is Krishna. Abhideya, the process is worshipping him. And the result is prema, that is the prayojana. We are going to discuss sambandhi tattvam, abhideya and prayojanam. Okay, these three things he defined. So Srila Jiva Goswami wrote, this is his interest. He wants to, so elaborate these three things. Before writing any book, so why you want to write this book? You will be having an idea. You want to expand what things in this book you will be having before itself, writing the book. It's not that the writing book and then after that you will come to know, this is the thing I want. No, that we should not do. So first of all, what you want to write, you should know first. What you want to expand in your book, you should know first. That's why he wants to expand these things in his book, Sandarbhas, book Sandarbhas. So then what he did to do this, so he is going to do the investigation. So he wants to find the pramana. That means to expand these three things, sambandhi tattvam, abhideya and prayojana. So he needs some pramana based upon which he can expand these. So then he started investigating on pramanas, various pramanas. So we learned in Tattva Sandarbha very nicely. So many hours we spent, and we finalized what is the highest pramana. So that is Srimad Bhagavatam. So that is a, now you see that yadyekatanam eva purana lakshanam apaurusheyam shastram sarva vedetihasa purananam arthasaram brahma sutropajivyam cha bhavat bhuvi sampurnam pracharat rupam syat satyam muktam yata eva cha sarva pramananam chakravarti bhutam asmad abhimatam srimad bhagavatam ye udbhavitam bhagavata. So anyway, this is the one line I just kept here. So why I kept, just to mention one point. So Srila Jiva Goswami started investigating the pramanas. In this loka, we are having the total 10 pramanas. In this material world, we are having the 10 pramanas. Pratyaksha pramana, anumana pramana, shabda pramana, upamana pramana, aitihya pramana, asha pramana, upalabdhi. Next, ardhapatti. Next, sambhava. Abhava, final one. Chesta, yes, chesta. There are the, very good. You all remembering nicely, huh? So I'm happy. So there are 10 pramanas. So are there in the 10 pramanas? So he did thorough investigation, and with Purupakshi, with strong Purupakshi. So he debated and finally concluded, shabda pramana is the, out of these 10, topmost is a, is a sabda, is a king of the all these 10. So among these 10, who is the king? That is a shabda. And that shabda, it can be, who is that shabda? That is, shabda is brahmadi dosha rahita vachana shabda. Of course, sometimes I use lot of Sanskrit words, and don't worry, so new students, you will be get habituated very soon to this. So because that also good actually, because many words, if you learn in Sanskrit itself, it will be very useful. So, and also we should start introducing Sanskrit words to the English world. That is very important, that we should do. Instead of taking the English words, if you want to promote, and if you want to promote any language, what you should do? You should keep on using that. You should keep on speaking that. And if you should keep on exchanging those words with others, then that language will be protected. Otherwise, that language and those words, the deep meanings of those words, everything will be, is out from the society. If words are out, then our thinking is also will become down. It will be shrinking. Our thinking will be shrinking if there are no deep words in your language. Then your thoughts always in the superficial level. So that's why it is very important to practice the deep words. That means who's having the deep meanings. That is very important. So Sanskrit language is having such a facility. That means you are using the deep meaning words, means your brain is also thinking like that. You're functioning like that. That means it is having the full amount of, so usage. You are using fully your the brain. If you don't use your brain, what will happen? It will become paralyzed. So that means sometimes after that, it will not able to understand anything. That's why it is better to promote the Sanskrit words, instead of using the so many English words. So one Sanskrit word is good. So try to get this kind of, so try to have this kind of habit. So so good. So now, at least you are all students of the Sandarbha, so I can use that. So out of this, Brahmadi dosha vachanatmaka shabdaha is the Brahmadi dosha rahitaha vachanatmakaha shabdaha. Shabda means the one which is free from the four defects. Shabda means the one which is, that is the sentence which is free from the four defects. That is the shabda. And that shabda is the king of among the these 10 pramanas. Okay, then after that we discussed that. So who is that which is free from the four defects? Who can be that kind of shabda? That is Veda. We understood why Veda only, that why not others. So many logical arguments we have seen. Anyway, so if anyone wants to know, so they can also read the refer the Tattva Sandarbha again, so they can easily get. So then after that, Vedas are the highest pramana till now. So after that, what we did in this Vedas, so what is the main problem we got? Vedas are not available fully now, and also Vedas are having the so various meanings according to the various sages. So it is difficult to come to the conclusion. So in this way, so some other reasons also are there. So we are not able to use Vedas fully. So next what we went? We went to the so Purana Itihasas, Purana Itihasam, Purana Itihasabhyam Vedam Samupabrahmayet. We took instead of Vedas, so Vedas are nicely explained and expanded by the Purana and Itihasa. That's why we took Purana and Itihasa as the highest pramana. So in that Purana Itihasa also, we selected the Satvik Puranas. So because they are discussing about the, so because Sattva Sanjayate Gnanam, Satvik Puranas will cause for the having the, so knowledge, that means Tattva Gnanam you will get by the, so Satvik Puranas only. So after that, we went to finally, so Srimad Bhagavatam, because this one among the Satvik Puranas, and also this Bhagavatam is the what? It is the natural commentary on the Brahma Sutras, which are compiled by the one among the six great sages. So in the Dwapara Yuga, if you see the six great sages are, who are those? So who is that? That means Gautama Rishi, Kanada, Patanjali, Kapila, Jaimini, Vyasadeva. Out of these six are the Astika Darshanas. Out of these six Darshanas, so which we are taking the supreme, that is the Vyasadeva's Darshana. The Darshan which is given by Vyasadeva. Why? Because this Vyasadeva is only the compiler of all the Vedas. This Vyasadeva is only the dividing all the Vedas, and he is writing all the Puranas. So that's why. And he is also summarizing all the Vedas in the form of Vedanta Sutras. That's why that Vyasadeva wrote this Srimad Bhagavatam, and that Vyasadeva gave the Vedanta Sutras. And this Srimad Bhagavatam is a natural commentary on those Vedanta Sutras, which are the summary of the all the Vedas. So that's why. So Srimad Bhagavatam, and also Srimad Bhagavatam is fully available. It's not that the half of the Bhagavatam is only available. Of course, it is commentary on the natural commentary on the Vedanta Sutras. And if it is not fully available, is there any use? No use. So, but luckily what? So somehow, it's a last plan actually. So we have this Srimad Bhagavatam in full extent everywhere it is available. And that's why finally, so we established Srimad Bhagavatam as the highest pramana. So after establishing the Srimad Bhagavatam as the highest pramana, Jiva Goswami in Tattva Sandarbha, what he is doing? So some question, what is that he wrote, someone wrote, what is that you see? Message? Books will share very soon, no problem. We'll be sharing the books. Okay. So next, okay, we'll go to the next point. So then after that, Jiva Goswami wants to expand three things, that is Sambandhi Tattvam, Abhideya and Prayojana. So for this, so he found Srimad Bhagavatam as the highest pramana. That means Srimad Bhagavatam is the best pramana or best book he can use to do this. So then what is there in the Srimad Bhagavatam? So that we should understand. So then we understood, if you want to understand the content of the Srimad Bhagavatam, then what is the best way? You should understand the heart of Sukadeva Goswami and the heart of Vyasadeva. If you understand their heart, then you can, because Sukadeva Goswami is the speaker of the Srimad Bhagavatam and Vyasadeva is the compiler of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So that's why if you understand their heart, then so it is easy to understand the essence of Srimad Bhagavatam. So if you investigate the heart of the Sukadeva Goswami, then Sukadeva Goswami is speaking the Srimad Bhagavatam, entire Srimad Bhagavatam. So what is the heart? That means according to Sukadeva Goswami's heart, so what is the Sambandhi Tattvam? Sri Krishna is a Sambandhitattvam. That means he is speaking book Srimad Bhagavatam. Okay? Book Srimad Bhagavatam. Book is the Srimad Bhagavatam. And it is discussing about Sri Krishna. So that means Sri Krishna is the subject matter and Srimad Bhagavatam is the book. So that means who is having the Sambandha with the Srimad Bhagavatam? Krishna. So that's why Krishna is what? Krishna is the Sambandhitattvam. Krishna is the Sambandhitattvam. So that means for the Srimad Bhagavatam book, Krishna is the Sambandhitattvam. And what is the Abhidheya? That means what process is explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam? Which process is recommended for the readers? Which process? That is Bhakti. Shravana Rupa Bhakti. Shravanadi Rupa. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Svaranam, Pada Sevanam, Archanam, Vandanam. So this kind of. So Bhakti is the recommended process in the Srimad Bhagavatam. The recommended process is also known as Abhidheya. So that's why that is recommended. And that is not only recommended, that is given. That is prescribed. That is a prescribed process. So doing this sadhana, doing the bhakti, sadhana bhakti is the process given by the Srimad Bhagavatam to us. So that's why Abhidheya, that means prescribed process, is the bhakti. This we are going to, with this we have seen, according to the Sukadeva Goswami's heart, so the recommended, the prescribed process in the Srimad Bhagavatam is bhakti. Next, what is the prayojana of this? Prema. Okay, now we went to the Vyasadeva. We tried to investigate the heart of the Vyasadeva. So for this, we took the Samadhi Slokas. So when he went to the Samadhi, in the Samadhi, he is seeing the various things. So based upon the Samadhi realizations, we also understood what is Sambandhitattvam, what is Abhideya, and what is Prayojana. So based upon the Vyasadeva Samadhi realizations, what is Sambandhitattvam? Sambandhitattvam is Krishna. And prescribed process is Bhakti. And the Prayojana is the Prema. So that means the speaker and the compiler both have the same opinion. So Sambandhitattvam, that means for the Srimad Bhagavatam book, Sambandhitattvam is Krishna. For the Srimad, in the Srimad Bhagavatam, prescribed process is Bhakti. And the Srimad Bhagavatam, the result, the benefit of doing that Bhakti is Prema. Okay. So now, in order to discern the conclusion methodically and in detail, according to the Sukadeva's heart, Sambandha, Abhideya, and Prayojana will be discussed in six sandarbhas. In six sandarbhas, what is done? This Sambandhitattvam, Abhideya, and Prayojana are discussed in these six sandarbhas. In these six sandarbhas, first four sandarbhas are discussing about the Krishna, Sambandhitattvam, that is Krishna. Okay? And Bhakti Sandarbha is discussing about the Abhideya, the prescribed process in the Srimad Bhagavatam. The prescribed process in the Srimad Bhagavatam, that is the Abhideya. And if you do that process, if you follow that process, then what is the result? That is the Krishna Prema. So that is a prayojan. That is discussed in the Preeti Sandarbha. So that's why for Sambandhi Tattvam is discussed in the four Sandarbhas. Tattva Sandarbha, Bhagavat, Paramatma and Krishna Sandarbha. In these four we studied Sattva Sandarbha. One sample is done. For sample we studied Tattva Sandarbha. So now that's why we jump to the next. Bhakti Sandarbha. Okay. For Sambandhi Tattvam, four are there. One we studied already. So we went to the next Sandarbha for the Abhideya. And after that, we'll go to the Prayojana Tattva, Preeti Sandarbha. In next semester, we'll study. In next year, Preeti Sandarbha. It's very easy, actually. It's not a very difficult subject. Preeti Sandarbha is also a technical book. And it's not that the Radha Krishna Prem, nothing. It's a simple aspects, basic aspects are there. Okay, so like this, six sandarbhas are organized to do this work. Now, first of all, how this sandarbha books are organized, how these books are. So that means this is having some systematic, some style is there. So sometimes Srimad Bhagavatam, if you take, it is having the cantos, yes, and also chapters and slokas. So then sandarbhas, how they look, it is divided into the, so sandarbhas, Bhagavat sandarbha, Shat sandarbhas are divided into sandarbhas, and each sandarbha is having anuschedas. Yeah, anuschedas. And every anuscheda is having the one sutrasthaniyam vakyam and one vishaya vakyam. It is very important. You should know the style, the arrangement of this book. Sutrasthaniyam vakyam and vishaya vakyam. Sutrasthaniyam vakyam is also, is what? Is the avatarika vakyam. Avatarika vakyam means introductory statement. Example, bhakti is nirguna. So this is the introductory statement. Now to prove this, so some vishaya vakyam will be there. Vishaya vakyam will be what? It will be the Bhagavata vakyam, Bhagavata sloka. What is that? Sri Bhagavata vakyam will be the vishaya vakyam. Okay, that means every anuscheda starts with the sutrasthaniyam vakyam, that is nothing but the introductory statement. And to explain this introductory statement, there is a vishaya vakyam. That vishaya vakyam is Bhagavata vakyam. Okay, clear? And to understand that Bhagavata vakyam, we are going to take whose commentary? Mainly Sridhar Swami's commentary. So who is Sridhar Swami? Sridhar Swami is a Parama Vaishnava. Srila Jiva Goswami says he is a Parama Vaishnava. He is a great exalted Vaishnava. And he is he is writing the commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam, but to attract the people who are Advaitins, especially who are Mayavadis, to attract them towards the Krishna, so he is giving the commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam, and it is a Vaishnava commentary. But some places he is having the some Amish Badishanaya, that means to catch fishes you will be using the bite. So to catch these Advaitins, Brahmava, that means so called, they always believe in the Brahman only. So Amisha Badishanaya. So to catch, that means them, some places he will be giving commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam with the view of Advaitavada. So very, very few places. So if that is like that, then Jiva Goswami is not going to take that. That part of thing he will not be going to take that. And also he is taking the commentary of the Srimad Bhagavatam based upon the South Indian Parama, the great exalted Vaishnavas. And also he is taking the commentary with the philosophy, with the opinion of the philosophy of the Sri Ramanujacharya. That means Ramanujacharya gave the Sri Bhashyam on the Vedanta Sutras. So based upon that Siddhanta, so he is going to accept the commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam. So, and also he is accepting the commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam slokas, Grandha Swarasyam, that means, so Grandha itself, the book itself is evidence, self-evident, that is. So if it is saying clearly, boldly, Krishna is having the form, absolute truth is having the form, then he is maintaining that everywhere. So that like this, so based upon the self-evidence of the Srimad Bhagavatam, also he is going to, so take the commentary of that Bhagavatam sloka. So that Bhagavatam sloka's commentary, Bhagavatam sloka's commentary will be the Bhashyam for this Sutrasthaniyam Vakyam. Okay, just on the board. Prabhu, where are the pens? So you can rotate the camera. I will use the Devanagari Lipi. Anuchedaha. I will also pronounce this and write, so that you can, if you don't know Devanagari, you can understand. Anuchedaha. So how it is organized? There is first Sutrasthaniyam Vakyam. Sutrasthaniyam Vakyam. What is this? This is Avatarika Vakyam. Okay, this is the introductory statement. Then after that, to elaborate this, what is there? Vishaya Vakyam. Who is this Vishaya Vakyam? This Vishaya Vakyam is Sri Bhagavata Vakyam. Vakyam means sentence. Okay? Vakyam means sentence. Okay? Now, this Bhagavata Vakyam, we cannot understand directly. Then we need what? Commentary. Commentary on the Bhagavatam. So what are the different ways to take commentary on this? One is the Sridhar Swami's commentary will take if it is fully according to the Vaishnava Siddhanta. Okay. And also we'll take the commentary on the slokas based upon the Sridhar Swami's commentary in the other places. In the Bhagavad Gita and Vishnu Purana also he gave the commentary. So we are also keeping that into account. So based upon that, so we will be selecting his commentary. It's not that the Jiva Goswami is taking as it is Sridhar Swami's commentary everywhere. So okay, this also he will maintain. And also he is taking the commentary on this Bhagavata Vakyam based upon the South Indian Vaishnavas. And also he is taking the commentary on this commentary for this Srimad Bhagavatam based upon the the South Indian exalted devotee who is coming in the parampara of the Sri Vaishnavas. So that is a Ramanujacharya, and he wrote the commentary on the Vedanta Sutras, that is Sri Bhashyam. And according to the opinion of Srimad Bhagavatam also, we are going to take the commentary. We are going to take the commentary of this Srimad Bhagavatam Vakyam. And also we are going to have the Grantha Swarasyam. That means, Grantha itself is self-evident. So Grantha is saying one place clearly about this some fact. So we will maintain that strictness. We cannot change the commentary of some other sloka which is going, it is breaking the other previously defined things. So that's why through the Grantha Swarasyam, self-evidence of the Grantha also, we are going to take the commentary of this Vishaya Vakyam, that is Srimad Bhagavata Vakyam. Okay. So these are the different ways to take. And also, sometimes, Srila Jiva Goswami, what he is going to do, in the next important one more point. Later. 2 minutes. So we are going to wind up the class. So just, I need 2 minutes. So sometimes Srila Jiva Goswami, while explaining, that means this Bhagavata Vakyam, so he is quoting so many Puranas and statements from the so many Puranas, also statements from the Upanishads, statements from the Tantras and other Samhitas and other various Smriti Shastras. So why he is doing? So why he is taking the references from the various other Granthas also? Just why he is taking, he is whatever Siddhanta he is thinking, while explaining this Srimad Bhagavata Vakyam, whatever Siddhanta he is thinking or he is mentioning to prove that he is going to take the references from the Vedas, Puranas, Itihasas and other scriptures, not to prove the Srimad Bhagavata Vakyam. Not to prove the Srimad Bhagavata Vakyam, but to prove the Siddhanta he thought. Okay, so if, that's why this is mentioned here. Srimad Bhagavatam is the emperor. In front of emperor, no one can speak, and no one has no opinion. He is whatever he says, everyone should follow. So that's why you should not say that. So to prove Srimad Bhagavatam, so we are giving these Upanishads. Are these, we are giving the statements from the Puranas? No. Then who will be superior? That Purana and that Vedas will be the superior. So that's why Srimad Bhagavatam doesn't need any other's help. It is already supreme. We discussed that in the Tattva Sandarbha, how it is supreme Pramana. Okay. So that is the point we should understand. So many times in the Bhakti Sandarbha also, you'll be having the hundreds and hundreds of the references from the various Puranas. Why those are all mentioned? Not to prove the Srimad Bhagavatam statement, but to the whatever Siddhanta Srila Jiva Goswami is establishing to prove that, he is mentioning those. For substantiating his point, so he is mentioning the quotes from other places also. Okay. And sometimes while mentioning, he will be mentioning from the some kind of Upanishads, which may not available now in those books, but those are all available in the, those are all quoted by the Madhvacharya. If Madhvacharya quoted and that quotation is not there in the such a respective book, so Jiva Goswami, never mind, he will mentions, because Madhvacharya is our Acharya, our Paramparacharya, so that's why we are going to take so his reference as the standard. Of course, it may not there in that respective book. Maybe for example, so some Kathopanishad, so there is a one statement Madhvacharya mentioned. But if you see the Kathopanishad, that is not there in the present version of the Kathopanishad. But we don't mind. So we take based upon the strength of the Madhvacharya's so quotation, so we can take that also. Okay. So next. So like this, you will be seeing the flow of the book. Okay, today we'll stop here. Somehow little bit is there in after this. Then that will finish in tomorrow's class, and then after that we'll go to the exact discussion. Any questions till here? Leela Govind Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Dandavat Pranam.
Dandavat Pranam Prabhu.
Guruji, I have a couple of doubts. Thank you for your wonderful introduction. Guruji, in this introduction you put here, in the course of the main text, Hare Krishna?
Yes, Prabhu, please.
You mentioned here it as a main text. Why did you not mention it as directly Srimad Bhagavatam?
Because Sandarbha is a generic word. It's a general word. Sandarbha is a general word. You can use Sandarbha word for anything. Bhagavat Sandarbha or some other Sandarbhas also. Many Sandarbhas are possible. Understanding? Sandarbha is a general word actually.
Okay.
So that's why. Understanding? Not understanding?
Not understood.
Okay. So like city is a general word actually. City can be anything, like Delhi city, like the so Hyderabad city. So city is a general word actually. Like that Sandarbha is a general word. It can be Bhagavat Sandarbha. It can be another Sandarbha, like this.
Okay.
And that generally Sandarbha, what it does, it is nothing but the collection of the, so it is the collection of the secret meanings of the main text, like guide okay. Means what guide means, it is a, okay. It's not a main book, it is a secondary book which is written, it is based upon the main text. You're understanding? Like
yeah. No, but for all Sandarbhas, you mentioned that Srimad Bhagavatam is the main text.
Yes, that's why we are knowing, we are saying all Sandarbhas as Bhagavat Sandarbha. Why? Because all Sandarbha total depend on, are dealing with the which main text, that is Srimad Bhagavatam. That's why in some total all you know as, you say them as Bhagavat Sandarbha.
Okay.
Okay, Prabhu. Okay. Next, others maybe you can ask later, Prabhu. Others also have questions.
Sure.
Yeah. Ashray Gorang Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. In Mangalacharan, there was a word, Nigama.
Ah, yes, Prabhu.
So I want to know what is the difference between Nigama and Agama? You studied Purana, you can explain because many times I understand, I couldn't find an answer.
As per my knowledge, so Nigama is the Vedas and Agamas, Agama Shastras, you can say Vaikhanasa Agama and Shakti Agama. So Agama Shastras are generally dealing about the worshipping of the deities. So Pancharatrika Vidhis actually, how to worship the various, the procedure, how to construct a temple and how to install a deity and how to do the service. So it's particularly deals about this Agama Shastras. But Nigama is generally a Veda. So that understanding I have. So if anything is there, then I will let you know. Okay, others? Sajdev Prabhu?
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhu, you said about Sandarbha. So there is one Krama Sandarbha also.
Yes.
So that is another example of that Sandarbha word.
Yeah, Krama Sandarbha. Good, Prabhu. Krama Sandarbha is the seventh Sandarbha on the Srimad Bhagavatam only, but it is going in sequence. That means from the first sloka to so till the last sloka, step by step it is given. So this is known as Krama Sandarbha. It is also on the Bhagavatam only, but it is Krama Sandarbha. Because it is following the sequence of the Srimad Bhagavatam. That's why to differentiate that as, that also you can call as Bhagavat Sandarbha only. But to differentiate two Bhagavat Sandarbhas, you should select the another name. So that's why he selected as Krama Sandarbha. Okay. Jai Gopinath Prabhu, yes.
Yes, thank you.
Class is over, so other students also, they can leave if they don't have any doubt and questions. So thank you very much for hearing. Yes, Prabhu, Jai Gopinath Prabhu, continue your question.
Yes, Prabhu. This in regard with Ashray Gauranga Prabhu's Nigama and Agama. Mm-hmm. And this Agama, are they equal to Vedas, as we say, the Puranas and Idhyasas, fifth Panchama.
Yes, Prabhu. Vedic literature, that is also Vedic literature. So that's why, like you see, example, Pancharatra Agama. So this is also given by the some great sage. So they, but depending on the Vedic philosophy, Vedic text only. So that's why they are all based upon the Vedas. They are all supplements.
Okay. So that is accepted as other thing, because there are many agamas for Saivites.
Yes.
And also for worshippers of Vishnu, there are many agamas. Shakti, so they are.
Shakti also. They are.
Shakti
there.
Also.
They are for Shiva.
Because sometimes based on that, they argue that, Shiva is supreme and it is given in this agama.
Yes.
So how to take that then?
Like how the Puranas are also telling Shiva as a supreme. If you see the Shiva Purana, Shiva is the supreme. So we discussed that how we dealt. So in that Kalpa, in the Tamasic Kalpa, prominently the glories of the Shiva is manifesting more. So those are compiled as the Puranas. So that is known as Shiva Purana. So same way.
Mm-hmm. So the Agama is meant for that Tamasic
That period of time. So that is a prominent, and that's why Shiva is supreme. It is said there.
Okay. So even in Agamas, then we classify them as Sattvic, Tamasic, and Rajasic.
Yes, definitely.
Okay.
Okay, Prabhu. Yes. Thank you very much. So, Sri Chand Prabhu, Hare Krishna. Yes.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu.
Prabhu, you told quoted Jiva Goswami to prove his thoughts. He quoted from other places also, apart from Bhagavatam, he quoted from other Puranas and other quotations.
Yeah.
So why he has to quote from other places if Bhagavatam is emperor?
Yeah, just for to substantiate his point. So already he is mentioning the Bhagavatam point, but apart from this, whatever he is additional point, whatever the some sub-siddhantas he is bringing out, and to establish that Bhagavatam, to explain this Bhagavatam sloka, so he might be needing this some other so points. So those points are some logics he is using, or some points he is using, some techniques he might be using. These are all not my whimsical things, but they are all based upon the Vedas only, like that. Okay.
Yes, Prabhu.
Ramchandra Prabhu.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Thank you, Prabhu. So Prabhu, like just quickly one thing, like you mentioned that Kram Sandharva is there, the seventh one. So what is the difference? Is it like just the same narration is there, or is it like in a different context that he wrote it, Kram Sandharva?
Yeah, Prabhu, Karma Sandarbha, if you see, almost 80 to 90% of six Sandarbhas data only is there. Same information is there. But it is there in the Krama. The Bhagavatam, Bhagavata Krama. How the Bhagavata text is flowing, sloka by sloka. So the now in the six Sandarbhas, so you'll be seeing the slokas which are telling about the Krishna as supreme. All are compiled as Krishna Sandarbha. But you're going to see in the Bhagavatam Krama Sandarbha, those are all distributed into different cantos and chapters. So in that place itself they are explained. So there itself he wrote the commentary on those slokas based upon the six Sandarbhas only. So that is known as, that's a Krama Sandarbha.
So if we study six Sandarbha, then 80% of Krama Sandarbha is done.
Yes, that is the point.
All right, thank you.